Thank you, Anastasia. Like all the speakers, I also want to start my speech with thanking the organizers, especially the ones we usually have seen, you and Justine. And I am the graduate of 2019 advanced program. So we were also kind of like silver lining lucky that before COVID, we were able to come see this program, what it gave to us, and your lovely city, Riga. So I also want to thank the rector, Pierre Rasulo, Leva Molina. Sorry, I couldn't participate in the law discussions because I'm not a lawyer or that do not have a law background. And I'm also going to introduce you an economic perspective, economic trade relations of European Union with Kazakhstan. So let me start my presentation. You can see it, right? So my topic was related with the trade relations and trade dynamics between European Union and Kazakhstan. You may have heard that Kazakhstan has become a member of Eurasian Economic Union also in 2015. So I look at in this framework how these relations also affect the European Union's trade with Kazakhstan and in bilateral relations. I say bilateral because in this work, I mostly take EU as a one party and Kazakhstan as a one party, but within the paper, I also analyze different aspects, different bilateral country-based analysis also. In general information, you can see the basic information that European Union and Kazakhstan has signed the PCA in 94, which entered force in 99, and the EPCA Enhanced Cooperation Agreement was signed in 2015 and entered into force in March 2020. We were hoping to see some results, actual practical results on the trade relation between European Union and Kazakhstan, but due to COVID, it will be not unwise to do some trade analysis because COVID-19 has also deeply affected the trade relations around the world. So we will see the actual results of this EPCA possibly in the following years. As of now, European Union as one party is the largest partner, trade partner of Kazakhstan, with $28 billion in 2019, which is mostly in favor of Kazakhstan, where EU imports around $21 billion and exports $7 billion. And in terms of investments, as you can see the figures also, more than half of the investment Kazakhstan attracts since the independence, 1991, comes from the European Union countries. And within them, we can see the top list, Netherlands, $90 billion, Switzerland, France, Italy, Belgium, and Germany. For Netherlands and Switzerland, it's possibly related with the energy sector, mainly the investments in the energy sector. For others, like France, Italy, Germany, possibly there are also some other sectors like diversified relationship between them. And when we look deeper into the information I just provided about investment, as you can see, since 2010, there were 650 foreign direct investment projects, which most of them comes from EU member states, with 185 also takes the first place, which Russia, Turkey, China follows with the respective numbers over there. But when we look at the, in terms of companies, we see that European Union number of companies, joint companies operating in Kazakhstan are fewer than the Russian, Turkish or other ones. Therefore, I believe in my analysis, I state that European Union investments basically exist during the projects, but not with a permanent scale, permanent style, like opening a firm operating here, like the Russian, Chinese, and Turkish ones are doing. As for the numbers, it's been indicated that there are 2,000 joint ventures operating in the country, which represents the whole union. A quick look at the bilateral relations also show us interesting trends. Here you can see till 2009, the bilateral trade between European Union as a single bloc and Kazakhstan was growing continuously. And after 2010, between 2010-13, due to global financial crisis, possibly biggest reason potentially, trade relations sharply declined, but mostly on the EU's import from Kazakhstan, but far lesser in Kazakhstan's export. From the years, it started with a modus of around 4 billion, then it reached around almost 34 billion around 2014, after 2010, but lately it's been decreasing, and the recent number for 2019 is around, like I said, 28 billion in total. And we look at the trade dynamics, of course, taking EU as a single bloc is also do not provide us enough information. So I look at the major countries who are conducting their trade with Kazakhstan also. We see four countries came up as the top countries: Germany, France, Italy, and Poland. These four countries consist 60% of trade relations between European Union and Kazakhstan. And when we look at even further, we see that the leader is Germany as a single country. Looking at the Germany's trade relation with Kazakhstan also, we see the top 10 exported products of Germany also consist 65% of Germany's total export. So we can see that those large figures we are seeing are actually highly concentrated only on few countries and few products in their trade relations. During the last 19 years, I also check at the historically, we see that around 32 products, new products, were added to EU's export list, which worth around 96 million. As for Kazakhstan, it's 55 products with around 340 million. So these figures comparing with the total number is quite slim, but when we compare their performance against each other, we see that Kazakhstan has actually done much better and diversified its exports towards European Union members. For the potential sectors, when we look at how they could increase their trade amount, their trade volume, especially in exports, that's what the country is always focused on, how they could increase their export to a certain country or group. We see that Kazakhstan has a great potential on exporting the oil seeds, fish products, machinery, and transport equipment to European Union, its member countries. As for EU, we could say that since there isn't much diversification in products, so the preferable analysis indicates that more member states need to conduct trade with Kazakhstan in order to increase the total number of European Union total foreign trade. Among these, Poland is an interesting example, which I briefly mentioned in my paper also, that Poland's export to Kazakhstan increased between 2000-2010. In terms of import, it started to increase after 2010. And as my thought indicates, that I also look at the trade relations between EU and Kazakhstan and the Eurasian Economic Union effect on it. Within Eurasian Economic Union, when it's established, it was hoped that it will boost certain level the economic cooperation and trade relations between its members countries, but it didn't occur so because the major economies like Russia, Kazakhstan, Belarus has been severely affected by the sharp fall in oil prices, sanctions against Russia, which also has a spillover effects to Kazakhstan and certain extent other countries too. We see that in 2013, it was almost internal trade, total trade was 70 billion, which sharply fallen in 3 years to 43. And then the latest number is 2009. So it looks like they lost at least 5 years and still trying to reach the before union establishment of the union numbers. But when we look at the internal trade dynamics, I see that Kazakhstan has increased its trade within Eurasian Economic Union also from within its total share from 18 to 22. So it's doing quite well within the union and is also affect to its relation, trade relation with EU was around only 1%. So it's quite minimal. Regarding the economic cooperation prospects, I also tried to analyze this from the political perspective because many experts believe that the founding establishment of the Eurasian Economic Union is also not purely economic, but also political sentiments included in it, mainly coming from Russia, although the idea was proposed by the first president of Kazakhstan, Nursultan Nazarbayev, during the mid-1990s. We see that there is an economic cooperation competition between European Union and Russia among the post-Soviet countries. The signing of association agreement of Moldova and Georgia in 2016, the signing of EPCA with Kazakhstan in 2015, and attempts to sign with Armenia also. When we look at all of their dates, we see that between 2014 and 2017, the competition was between Russia and the European Union was intensified. As we can see, European Union takes some lead on it because when we look at the association agreement, it also includes sub-agreements like Deep Comprehensive Free Trade Agreement, which prevents those countries to join the Eurasian Economic Union, or if you are a member of the Union, you cannot sign the same agreement with EU due to some different and many technicalities. Therefore, the Eurasian Economic Union and Kazakhstan joining in it in terms in trade amount might cause them to lose only 1%, but it blocked, prevented the future potential of enhancing relations with EU. Second reason we can say the growing influence of China in Central Asia, especially with Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, therefore speeding up the process of turning customs union in 2013 to economic union just in 2 years also could be associated with this Russia's concern about competition, economic trade competition between EU and Russia. In trade regulations, how it affects Kazakhstan's trade agreements, because Kazakhstan also become the member of World Trade Organization in 2015, like many things appearing in 2015, the EPCA, WTO, and becoming the European Economic Union member. So when I look at that, I see that Kazakhstan has managed to buy some time for itself. We see that, and also according to the Article 24 of the General Agreement of Trade and Tariff with Kazakhstan on behalf of WTO indicates that any agreement which conflicts with the WTO agreements, the WTO agreements overrules the regional agreements. So there was an interesting moment. Also, people were also thinking how it will continue because Kazakhstan's commitment on average tariff level for European Economic Union is around 74%, while its commitment to WTO is 6.5. So if Kazakhstan started to put the 7.4, then Kazakhstan still pay other WTO member countries the difference in the average tariff level due to regulations in the WTO. But for now, we see that Kazakhstan will start the negotiations of reaching that level in 2024. So even after the starting the negotiations, it could take several years or as long as it takes. So in terms of its commitments to the European Economic Union, it looks like Kazakhstan has quite achieved a flexibility because Kyrgyzstan has to apply this this year, and for Armenia, I think it's 2021, they have to commit, start their commitments. But on that point, Russia has been said that promised that it will cover the difference cost for Kyrgyzstan. You can do it for Kyrgyzstan because the economy of Kyrgyzstan is quite small compared with Kazakhstan. But for Kazakhstan, for Kazakhstan, it will cost huge amount of money because almost half of the total trade conducted Kazakhstan conducts with other WTO members is, you can calculate Kazakhstan trades around 60 billion, so within 30 billion, and all those fees every single year is not possible promise, I think. Therefore, for Kazakhstan, this flexibility option, time option, looks like given. And we look at the sectoral share because when we look at the trade figures, we see big numbers, and within these big numbers, mainly trade volume is associated with the energy sector. But when we look at the, in terms of number of products, this is the EU's export to Kazakhstan and its import from Kazakhstan. When we look at in terms of numbers, we see a balanced structure in this export and import. On here, in order to clarify some points, difficult to imitate research good means high technological goods. Easy to imitate is goods which require not technological requirements, but not so much. Capital intensive, as it says, products produced mainly with the capital, and labor intensive and raw material intensive goods. And within that, when we look at the top 10, as I also mentioned, this takes the major part in the trade relations. We see that EU's top export products to Kazakhstan, mainly difficult to imitate goods and medicaments, tubes, pipes, and other stuff. And you can also see their value, their share. Look at when you look at the import product, you see almost 90% is actually petroleum and oil and crude oil. And the remaining parts goes along with the natural resources. And one of the few things like pig iron and wheat and unmilled wheat is some of the products entering the top 10, which is not energy. But in here also we see a higher concentration because EU is largest partner. Within EU, there are a couple of countries, and within them, we see only few products have been traded, but these few products also consist a large share within the Kazakhstan's total import. So for example, 61% of total rotating electric plants and 60% of medicaments Kazakhstan import from around the world is actually comes from EU and from those selected countries. And the potential reason for this possibly the high comparative advantage of these countries on these products because they have a good revealed comparative advantage scores in general. Therefore, within its relation with EU is also expected to assume that probably one of the major reasons why there is a high concentration on these countries and on these products potentially, they are the best. That's why Kazakhstan is buying from them. And when we look at the trade indices, there are numerous index which tells you and describes a general picture for you how is to trade and potential of trade between two countries or between one country and one block. And as you can see in first on the left trade complementary index, here, if the figure is close to one, here you can see that it's close to, if it's close to one, it's better. When we look at the EU-Kazakhstan relations, it's going down. As for Kazakhstan to EU, it's growing up. It means that complementary structure of EU's export to Kazakhstan is decreasing, meaning what Kazakhstan is selling, so what EU is selling might not be needed in Kazakhstan. As for Kazakhstan, what Kazakhstan is selling seems to be in demand for EU. On the right side, you can see trade intensity is how intensively they trade with each other, because every country has more than 100 and 150 countries they're trading with. Within that, the intensity index shows us how much they trade with each other comparing with others. When you look at the EU, and Kazakhstan, you see that the same trend could be shown. The EU and Kazakhstan is trading, especially after 2015, starts to trade with more with other countries than with each other. And for the figures for Kazakhstan, that's why they are so huge, because when I take the EU as a single block, the number is huge comparing the Kazakhstan total figure. But as a trend, you can see the general trend. In order to conclude, as I already partially said previously, well, in order to increase the trade potential between EU and Kazakhstan, EU needs to focus on diversifying trade goods. And if more EU members trade to Kazakhstan, the EU's total export could increase to Kazakhstan. As for Kazakhstan, could put special emphasis on rapidly developing, especially now, energy sectors and products like oilseeds, fish, and machinery transports. And the potential EPCA and its opportunities we will see in the following years. And we will also observe how it will be shaped even after 2024, when Kazakhstan is finally set its commitments to the European Economic Union also. These are the general trend lines, general information, which I described in my paper. If you have any questions, you are welcome.
Thank you, Zhenki-san, for a slightly different, the economic perspective on this matter. I would like to remind that the second panel session tomorrow will also be devoted to EU economic support and economic relations with the neighboring regions. So definitely feel free to join that. And now let's proceed to the Q&A session.
Thank you very much, Anastasia. Thank you for your interesting presentation, focused on economic factors and issue. I would like to start. You mentioned, if I understand correctly, that for Kazakhstan, joining the Eurasian Economic Union had both positive and negative reverberations in terms of trade with the EU. Could you elaborate a little bit more in depth on both aspects?
Yeah, sure. As I show that in terms of trade amount, there's a big change. There's only slightly 1% reduction, but when we look at as a whole package, we see that the economic cooperation aspect between EU and Kazakhstan cannot go further because it's been blocked by its membership with Eurasian Economic Union. That's why when we look at the future developments, I think the EPCA will be the latest stage because the Kazakhstan's commitment to Eurasian Economic Union will prevent Kazakhstan to enhance its cooperation on agreement base, let's say like that. In terms of monetary, it could raise, but in terms of agreement base, there won't be any future steps. Actually, I also mentioned in this, in my paper also, it's not especially for EU, but it's also for China, because Chinese presence, especially in our neighbor country, Kyrgyzstan, is rapidly increasing and in some proportionate in Kazakhstan also. And many cheap products and some high quality products of China easily could be traded, could be sent to Kazakhstan, which have a high demand because in Kazakhstan, there is only three different type of products. We say that the cheap layer includes Chinese one, medium layer means Russian and Turkish one, and high quality means European and Western one. But high quality means higher prices. That's why Russia and Turkish products mainly preferred by the customers in general. When we look at in macro perspective, we see that this cannot happen because the tariff rates will be much higher. So Chinese products already lost their competitive advantage. So by joining the EU, Eurasian Economic Union, Kazakhstan is actually buying, importing potentially same products with higher prices, which gives a leverage for Russian products. Therefore, the union works for its purpose, but within this analysis, I can say that products imported from European Union is not affected much because they're already high. So people are not buying because they are cheap. People are buying the quality and the brand of European Union trademark, like made in Germany, made in France. They are buying the level. So in terms of trade amount, it's possibly because of that, it's not decreased so much, but future potential has been blocked. If I could answer your question.
Yes, thank you very much. You did. Yeva, do you have questions?
Yes. Thank you very much for your presentation. I have a question. What is the role of the division of the Caspian Sea? Because it's not territorially divided and it's bordering also other Central Asian states and it's rich in resources. Could you please comment on that?
Well, the Caspian issue is an issue for almost
It looks like we are having a little bit of an internet connection problem. Let's see if Genghis-Khan is able to reconnect in a couple of seconds. Okay, let's, while we're waiting until Genghis-Khan reconnects, I will once again remind that we are having the second day of the conference tomorrow. We'll have three panel sessions, one on the role of good governance and administration reform, the second one devoted to economic issues, as I mentioned, EU relations with neighboring regions, and the final panel session will be devoted to issues of fundamental rights in a democratic society. And Genghis-Khan has rejoined us, so let's try again.
Yeah, so there was a blackout in my district. So just in first 1 second. About Caspian. Well, the Caspian issue is an issue for many years. And although they signed some latest agreements about how they're going to divide it, but there is the battle of national interests going on there, because Russia and Iran want something else and Azerbaijan wants another solution. Although they look like they came to an agreement, but between this latest agreement, I think it did not include the energy sources. In terms of world, there are many agreements has been signed, but in terms of energy, as far as know, to my knowledge, there is still no single agreement or cooperation.
Thank you. Thank you for your questions, and thank you, Genghis-Khan, for your presentation.